Game Builder's Garage is a very unique type of game building software. Many people have taken this opportunity to explore 3D platformers or other types of unique levels. However, motion controls and related have gone criminally underexplored. There are other types of level design software like Dreams and Mario Maker, but Game Builder's Garage is unique in that it gives you almost complete control through the various gyroscopes and sensors built into the Joy-Cons. While the Wii set the standard for motion controls being included in many gaming consoles in the future, Switch hardware is very unique. Every controller has two Joy-Cons, which have their own sets of gyroscopes, accelerometers, etc., an IR camera, and a touchscreen. Game Builder Garage is a very unique opportunity that gives you access to this type of hardware. Even though more game building software will come out in the future, knowing Nintendo, the Switch's design is probably not coming back. My point is that even though many types of game building software will come out in the future, this is your one really good opportunity to make heavy use of motion controls and all sorts of sensors that the Switch has that you can't really expect people to have in the future. Thus, it's my opinion that if you're not really experimenting with tilt controls and related sensors in Game Builder's Garage, you are wasting your one golden opportunity to try this out, as you'll probably not get access to this combination of hardware ever again, even if you were to become a game dev. Today I'm gonna talk about the really weird motion controls that you have access to in Game Builder's Garage, how to use them, how they work, etc. Hey, Lou from the future here. Turns out, there's a lot to know about these types of control schemes, so I'm splitting this up into a couple of bite-sized videos. In part one, first we're gonna talk about how the different control schemes will work for tilt and motion controls. Then I'll focus on tilt, then if face up, followed by rotation speed and shake. In part two, I'll talk about hand, then IR camera, and in part three, I'll talk about touch controls in general. And I'll have a little camera on the side screen so you can see exactly what's going on. I hope you enjoy the ride. Before we focus on how tilt controls work specifically, first we need to understand exactly how the game picks up different controllers. You don't want to have a situation where you're actually picking up the wrong controller or your ranges are bad. When working with tilt controls, the first thing is to specify what controller you're looking at. You can focus on the console, a specific Joy-Con, or a certain controller port. If you set it to automatic, then the game will try its best to figure it out. When working with tilt controls, keep in mind that sometimes people will use Joy-Cons and sometimes people will have a controller. So here, for example, I have a Pro Controller, and when I connected it to my Switch, it's on controller port number 2. We can see what the tilt is doing over here, where if I move my Joy-Con like so, you see that little indicator moves back and forth, and I'm on player 1. Because we set it to automatic, and we have two controllers, the game will prioritize the Joy-Con over the Pro Controller's gyroscope. So here, even when I'm moving my Pro Controller in every possible way, it doesn't care. The controller port thing is something that's very important to understand when working with motion controls, because a lot of times, you'll make a level that you say, okay, player, I need you to go grab your Joy-Cons, but their Pro Controller is already attached. So they put down their Pro Controller aside, they go grab their Joy-Cons, then the Joy-Cons are on controller port number 2. But if you specify Joy-Con left or Joy-Con right, that is going to be, by default, set to controller port number 1, and you probably did your testing on controller port number 1, meaning that the game will not care. You can get over this sometimes by defining a tilt node on multiple specific controller ports. The next main option is digital versus analog, where in digital, the signal is either 0 or 1 if you exceed a certain threshold value, and analog controls give you exactly what the angle is smoothly. This is all standard fare for like controller node-ons, but usually this becomes a huge deal for tilt controls. You really don't want a situation where a small shake of your controller will send your character flying. You have to be a lot more careful when designing dead zones with motion controls. Now that we got this out of the way, let's focus on the first motion control node-on. This brings us to the first starter of the show, the tilt node-on. A tilt node-on works in handheld, Pro Controller, or individual Joy-Cons. In its settings, you can set standard digital and analog controls, as well as the axis of rotation. Now, we can set the output to either tilt or angle of rotation. While this diagram makes it look like tilt gives you a number between -1 and +1, it actually gives you a number between -0.5 and 0.5. I don't know why. The other option is to just output the angle of rotation without any bells and whistles here. Does this make an actual difference? Well, this is set to angle of rotation, this one is set to tilt, and we're just multiplying by 360. If you take the difference, then no matter what I do with this controller, there's no difference. It literally just multiplies it to give you an angle. This should give you an idea of how the tilt node-on works. Based on the gyroscope, this controller has its own defined direction for where 0, 0 should be. Then, whenever you tilt the controller, its new direction goes in some other vector. And what you're measuring is this angle of exactly how it's been tilted off of this axis. Now you can look at rotation along the x-axis, the z-axis, like this, or along the y-axis. You'll notice that the tilt nodon has this Y reset port. This is because, due to gravity, there's no real way for your Joy-Con to know if you are pointed left versus right. So whenever you're using Y-axis-based tilt, you'll normally want to define a button to reset this position, so that if you're looking at your controller, if you're sitting relative to your monitor like this, that you can redefine this direction as Y equals zero, so you go left or right from over here. While tilt is maybe simple enough, you have to keep in mind that there's actually a singularity, because when you get this angle relative to your original position, there comes a point where this angle is between negative 180 and positive 180. So whenever you're changing this angle in that range, you see with the extend nodon, we are coming across a super sharp turn. This sharp turn is extremely important, because if you are using tilt controls and you go anywhere near this singularity, then your character is gonna start flickering around and you'll be very, very confused. I'll go into more detail on how to best use this later, but that's enough for now. So now that you understand the basics for tilt controls, the others will be a lot faster to explain. The face-up nodon doesn't really do exactly what it says. It sounds like it's a 1 if it's face-up and a 0 if it's face-down, which is technically true. However, the face-up nodon has a lot more to it than that. You have standard digital and analog controls, but you can also change which side counts as face-up. So here, when I hold my Joy-Con normally with a front face-up, it gives me a 1. And if I flip it around, that goes to 0, but it does so continuously. If I change this to left, then I'm checking if this left side of the Joy-Con is pointing up. So here, this gives a 1, and then changes continuously as I rotate all the way to 0. So exactly what's going on here? Now imagine if the Joy-Con, or whatever controller, has its own face, where in the settings for face-up nodon, you define a vector that goes straight up from that face. So here, if it's front, then this is what that vector looks like. What face-up nodon does is it compares the gravity vector to the normal vector, or the facing vector, for the controller. While tilt control gives you the angle between these two vectors, the face-up nodon gives you a modified dot product. So instead of going from negative 1 to 1, it goes 0 to 1, but the idea is the same. So if these two vectors are the same way, then you get the maximum value. And if they are perpendicular, and it doesn't matter exactly what type of perpendicular they are, even if they're rotated relative to each other, this all gives you the same lower value. And this goes all the way until they are completely opposite with a value of 0. But there are actually two important things to note here. This angle does not care exactly how it's rotated. Here in this example, I have tilt nodon. Tilt x that feeds in an absolute value, so whether it's x positive or x negative doesn't really make a difference, just like face-up nodon. Then I map them so they're on a comparable scale. You can see that if I tilt my Joy-Con in this x-axis, that the output is basically the same. However, there are two key distinctions. This is not a shorthand for tilt in x, because if I tilt in z, this is also measuring that difference. This example will give you a clearer picture. Here's the same x versus front as before. They look completely paired with each other. Now, if I tilt in just the z-axis, then that will also work pretty smoothly. However, if I tilt in a combination, we can start seeing very different results. Furthermore, if you remember that singularity we talked about before, that X tilt goes completely haywire near that value, whereas the face-up nodon has no such problem. No matter how you rotate the face-up nodon, there's not going to be a spot where it spontaneously swaps around between different values. It's pretty smooth. The way I describe it, the face-up control is very similar to a tilt control. The main difference is that it's much more robust. You don't really get the ability to measure up versus down. There's not really a difference between those two, but it's also a lot more robust against weird rotations. So depending on the type of motion you're trying to capture, this one should be near the top of the list. Keep in mind that the console can do all of these, but it's generally pretty hard to work with your console in handheld mode when you're tilting it around at different angles. Now let's talk about more literal motion controls. Tilt and face up measure the current angle of the Joy-Con or whatever other controller you're using. Rotation speed and shake measure what you're doing to the Joy-Con. Rotation speed lets you change the axis of rotation, just like with tilt. You can also set rotation speed to any rotation axis, so it'll pick up any sort of rotation that you're trying to go for. Here, I'm gonna use this main axis for demonstration. I can set the direction of the response. So if I rotate negative X, I get a negative number, and if I rotate positive X, I get a positive number. Now I can set the rotation speed to only count one type of rotation. So here it completely ignores the negative X rotation and only checks the positive X rotation, or vice versa. Shake is like rotation speed, but in a linear way. Shake outputs between 0 and 1. And we can first start out by any sort of motion. So any direction that you move in will trigger the sensor. And the faster you swing, the bigger the output number. You can also set shake to only one specific direction. So here, it'll only work when I punch forward, but not when I retract backwards. And these are all completely separated. With these motion controls, they literally respond to motion. If you are not moving, there is no input. Let's say I'm making a motion like casting a fishing line, all right? So a motion like this. Here you can see that both the rotation speed and shake are picking up this motion just fine, but they don't catch it quite the same. The rotation is really sensitive to the flip, where I'm going like this. Whereas if I'm casting my fishing line like so, and I'm barely rotating my Joy-Con at all, it's more like a punch, then it's not really catching this. Shake is limited to a certain direction. So here, when I cast the fishing line, it can check that I'm just sending my line out and then have zero output when we're going backwards. However, you want to be very careful controlling angle. So let's say that you're controlling a rocket, and so you're using a rotation control, and now you went this far up. All right, now the tilt control can sense that angle. And let's say that I've made my game such that in this situation, I can continue to want my rocket to keep rotating in that direction. We want to keep going, but I'm already at that awkward angle. I don't want to keep going, but I need to rotate even more awkwardly in that angle to make that work. Whenever you're using these nodons, be very, very careful to not put the player in a situation where they want to go even further outside the range. Because here you're trying to catch the motion. You're trying to catch the actual flinging of the fishing pole. You're not trying to sense that, oh, the line is out at a certain angle. This is actually very critical to actually capturing any sort of motion. Whenever you're making a set of motion controls, you want that to feel really good, very consistent, and very smooth. When you have that motion in your mind of what you think you want to happen, so like casting out a fishing pole, there's a lot of aspects to this motion, all right? You have the tilting of the fishing pole, you have the actual movement, so here in Y, we're shaking down, or the rotation speed, the flick of the fishing pole. As level designer, it's your job to figure out what part of this motion is the most consistent. Don't try to capture all the different parts of this motion, otherwise you're gonna have a really bad time. Focus on like one aspect of that motion that's super consistent that you can reproduce very, very consistently. For this case, I'd use the shake to do like a button press, kind of like casting out my fishing line. Whereas a tilt control, I would use that to show a graphic of where the fishing line currently is. So let me show you with a real example. Let me show you a level that I made here using a tilt-controlled rocket. You see that I have pretty good control over exactly where the rocket goes, to the point where the tilt controls aren't really a hindrance. If anything, they're actually better than stick controls for this. I want to focus on the fact that I'm moving the rocket in a 180 degree range, but am I moving my hand 180 degrees? Absolutely not. Like, that's super uncomfortable, right? So when I defined the tilt controls for this level, what I did is I made sure that this tilt is mapped in such a way that a 70 degree range maps to the full 180 degrees, either 90 degrees up, 90 degrees down, of the rocket. You have enough of a wide range to input a precise set of angles, but not so wide that it's uncomfortable to move your hand that far around. And that's critical for making good tilt controls. In my personal opinion, tilt controls are best when you need the player to input a specific angle. I know people like to do the whole marble rolling monkey ball thing, but usually stick controls are better for that. This concludes part one on tilt controls and motion controls. Stay tuned for part two, where I'll discuss hand controls and the IR motion camera, and later part three for touch controls. If you like this content, feel free to like and subscribe, and I'll see you then. Later.